OPS 122, Government and Politics in Africa. Today we are in Knowledge Area 4, which is all about democracy and democratization process in Africa. My name is Ahmed Musa from the Open University of Tanzania. In this lecture, our focus will be directed toward the following areas. One among those areas is democratic transition from single-party system to multi-party system. Another area of focus is the functioning of the single-party system. Also, we shall look upon the factors leading to change of system, meaning from one system to another, either from multi-party to single-party or from single-party to multi-party system. Also, we shall have an opportunity to see or to discuss upon the functioning of multi-party system or multi-party politics. Dear students and everyone, now let us start looking into our first area of discussion, which is one-party system and multi-party system. Here we'll have an opportunity to see the meaning of multi-party system, thereafter one-party system, which will give us a background to understand some other aspects in our lecture. Beginning with a multi-party system. A multi-party system is a system in which multiple political parties have the capacity to gain control of government separately or in coalition. Here, political parties have the capacity or an opportunity to gain control of government separately or in coalition. That is the multi-party system. It is a system where there are large amounts of major and minor political parties that all hold a serious chance of getting into power. That's one form of a party system that we'll be discussing in this lecture. Another form is one party system, or in another name, single party system. So all these names will be used in this lecture. A one party system is a type of political system which one political party has the right to form the government, usually based on the existing constitution. The constitution has designed to favor the existence of a single party. This may happen in two ways. First, the activities of the opposition may be completely outlawed, such that even the opposition leaders are not allowed to participate in elections. This may be known as de facto one-party state. If this political environment exists, then we refer to de facto one-party state, second manifestation that allows this one-party system is that the chances of opposition to clinch power are thwarted by an unfavorable legal framework that is in place. And sometimes we notice that in some cases a dominant political party that is in power only allows other less dominant parties who are allied to it to exist, while completely outlawing the dominant oppositional parties. Therefore, one-party state or one-party system could operate in an authoritarian context or even in some cases in a multi-party framework setup because of these two manifestations. You can see this type of political environment existing either in authoritarian regime or in multi-party framework setup. Now let us shift our attention to another aspect of this lecture, which is all about the shift of African states from multi-party system to one-party system soon after gaining independence. One-party system is among major characteristics of many African states, particularly immediate after they gain independence, particularly between the years of 1960s to the 1980s. During this time, a veritable mass movement occurred in Africa away from multi-party system, which had at first prevailed at the times of fighting for independence. We can remember during the times of struggle for independence, there was prevalent existence of multi-parties, different pluralism of political parties who were all together fighting for independence. Therefore, soon after gaining independence, there was a dramatic shift from the multi-party system toward the one-party system. We can have clear examples. For instance, in the 1970s, the Burkina Faso, Ghana, Liberia, Madagascar, Nigeria, Sierra Leone, Sudan, exited democratic governments, were short-lived soon after independence and turned into authoritarianism. Also, more controversially, apartheid in South Africa and Northern Rhodesia, now Zimbabwe, held regularly competitive elections, but with the franchise restricted to minority Europeans' population. Also, you can notice that elsewhere in Africa, authoritarian incumbents used co-optations, exile, and imprisonment to silence the weak and fragmented pro-democracy forces until concerted in international and domestic pressures sparked by third wave of democracy, they compelled them to democratize their regimes. So that was the political environment soon after independence. So if most of African states shifted from multi-party character or multi-party system towards one-party system, what were the reasons for such a shift? What was the reasons? There are factors or reasons for a change toward one-party system that was caused by these states. One of those reasons have been highlighted by different scholars say that many scholars have attributed this shift to various factors, including the fact that democracy was considered alien to Africa. They were saying democracy was alien to Africa. For instance, apologists of the one-party regime maintained that African traditional societies were akin to one-party system. That is what they are saying, giving the reasons why most of African states were shifted from one-party to one-party system. Another reason provided by proponents of one-party system is that multi-party regimes were divisive, hence unfit for the newly independent African states, which needed a unified energy and the enthusiasm so as to move forward. They said that multi-party regimes were divisive in nature. They provide an environment for divisions, to divide the societies to occur within their state. Hence, such divisive nature is unfit for a new independent African state, African states, which needed unifying energy and enthusiasm so as to move forward. Thus, any divisive aspect possibly available would have easily dismantled the newly weak states at the time. Thus, they opted to shift into one-party state, arguing that system will unify their people at that time. Also, they provided the reason that the one-party framework was deemed to be an important ingredient for national building. A single-party system is, if well structured and committed to social contract, could be a better conduit for banning and upholding important values that are required for national building. It can be termed as the software through which management of public affairs are managed. Thus, they say the one-party system will be a unifying factor. Just say that it will be termed as a software through which management of public affairs will be properly managed. That's why they opted to shift toward that. Generally, one-party system was all favor because it was believed that having centralized the form of governance would hasten economic development. That was the general idea behind the shift. Dear OPS 102 students, now let us turn our attention into another aspect of our lecture, which is concerned about the functioning of one-party system. We have seen that soon after attaining the political independence, most of African states tend to shift from multi-party system toward mono-party systems. Various reasons have been provided toward such a shift. So let us see how one-party system tends to function thereafter. One, to begin with, in most part of Africa, one-party system degenerated into authoritarianism and became a hindrance to economic development. Mostly, the one-party system became a bird of corruption, a disregard for merit by rewarding powerful positions to officials, those who show or plead to be loyal to the party or to the president. Therefore, instead of being a unifying factor, a one-party rule or one-party system became a missile of separatist tendencies, especially among the smaller tribes that sought to express themselves for having no adequate representation in government. They tend to express, or they wanted to express themselves through civil societies, but this just governance environment was lacking. Also, by the late 1970s, the economies of many African countries adopted one-party or one-party systems as a strategy of growth and development, were faced with crises of microeconomic imbalances, manifested in high rates of inflation, accelerating foreign exchange constraints, unmanageable balance of payments and fiscal deficits, and high external debts. So that is what it tells us here. It tells us that one-party rule proved that national building cannot be achieved where the freedom of members of the legislature, for instance, the interest groups, local authorities, and the other avenues of popular participation, such as the media, the bureaucrats, are curtailed. Once this governance environment are this way, now it's said that the chances of development is very minimal. Now let us turn into another aspect of our lecture, which is all about the democratic transition from one-party system to multi-party system. During 1990s, a dramatic political transformation has been underway in most parts of Africa. The unfolding process of democratic transition in Africa is part of what Harvard political scientist Samuel P. Huntington has termed the wave of democratization in the modern world. The first wave, as has been posed by Samuel Huntington, was from the year 1828 to 1926, when the modern democracy expanded from its intellectual roots in the American and the French Revolution to the Western Europe and parts of Latin America. Before then, it invaded by the rise of fascism in Italy and Germany. This was the first wave of democratization, according to Samuel Huntington. The second wave was from the year 1942 to 1962. Here, witnessed the advent of democracy in Germany, Italy, and Japan, in most Latin America, and in the Asia and African countries, gaining independence from European colonial rule. For instance, the years of 1962 until 1973 witnessed a reversal of the second wave as authoritarian governments repressed most of the fledging democracies in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. The third wave began on April 25th, 1974, with overthrow of Portugal's 48 years old authoritarian government in a peaceful military coup. By the installation a year later of one of the world's most successful democracies. From this ionic beginning, the third wave spread rapidly to Spain, Greece, across Atlantic, to Latin America, Asia, and then to Africa. For instance, taking an example of African countries who have been affected by this third wave of democratization was in 1980s, witnessed intermittent but discernible movement toward democracy on the continent. For instance, in Zimbabwe, 1980s, and in Namibia, in 1989, who negotiated a settlement to protracted civil wars, facilitated the establishment of democratic government through multi-party system. Also, in 1983, the Senegal elected its first government through multi-party elections after 20 years of single-party rule. The democratization process in Africa also affected the South African minority regime, whose decadent apartheid policy had became an obstacle to economic growth and social progress of the country. Now, these, all that have been explained here, are the effects or the influence of the third wave of democratizations that has been happening over there within African states. So these are examples of those shifting from a single party rule to a multi-party system. Also, another landmark event that contributed toward this shift was in 1989, when the communism and the Berlin Wall fell and marked the end of the Cold War. In the aftermath of Cold War, the third wave, the one which we explained in a little while, the third wave fostered a supportive international environment for the incipient movements toward democracy in Africa. Now, let us see the factors for a change from one-party system to multi-party system in Africa. Transition toward democracy was a symptom of the growing pressure on African authoritarian rulers for political and economic liberalization. The source of this pressure was the severe economic crisis caused by a combination of global recessions in the early 1980s and misguided domestic policies of market controls, trade restrictions, deficit spending, and inflated currencies. Also, these reasons, combined with another factors, which is this one, the movements were boosted, this shift, were boosted by the attitudes of European donors. Also, the European donors contributed much to the shift, to this shift from the authoritarian rule and a single-party system to a multi-party system. The Western donors, who advocated multi-party system, good governances, and the respect of human rights as a precondition for aid. We remember most of African countries were much affected by economic crisis. Then come the Western donors with preconditions for aid. You must change from single party rule to multi party rule. Why? We say that we shall see why they abide with these conditionalities in the forthcoming factors. Say that as the African leaders were desperate for aid and grants from the West, they could not ignore these demands since following the collapse of socialist systems, that is Russia and Eastern Bloc regimes, could no longer afford to support satellite states in Africa. Another factor for the change toward the multi-party system was the failure of single-party system to deliver what they had promised and the common people felt betrayed, leading to pressure for change. The people felt that through competitive politics and opposing parties, the government would feel pressure to perform. Therefore, people advocated a change into another political system because they thought that through competitive politics and opposing parties, the government would feel pressured to perform. Therefore, multi-party system, which has a form of competition, was seen suitable than being in single-party system. Another factor is the role of structural adjustment economic policies. By the end of the 1980s, structural adjustment in the economies was prevalent, and the interference and control of the single party government was noted as a root cause of the economic challenges being faced. Therefore, the structural adjustment program advocated that the change of system toward liberalism and liberal political practices, therefore, the structural adjustment program advocated the change of system toward liberalism and liberal political practices. This progression was characterized by establishment of new fangled norms and policies, institutional building and good governance. The existence of multipartism was the first step toward achieving these developmental goals through free and fair elections and the promotion of the media and civil societies as a watchdog. Now, after seeing the reasons for the shift from single party toward multipartism, now let us see how multipartism or the multi-party systems functions in Africa. A democratic transition in Africa did not always produce the desired democratic outcomes due to a combination of politically astute authoritarian rulers and politically inept pro-democracy forces. Second, say that although many states embraced multi-party systems, the incumbent regimes were retained in their first multi-party elections, like the case of Tanzania, Kenya, Mozambique, and many other African states. Importantly, adoption of multi-party systems only opened up avenues for wider political participation by the public in those countries. People could question what their governments were doing as opposed to the single-party era, where they were just given orders which they could only question within the party structure or party structures only. Also, during election within an environment of multi-party system, the incumbent regimes have used the state organs to their advantage to strangle the oppositions. Incidents of rigging, means election rigging, fraud and intimidation have been characterized the multi-party elections, making them to be rated as not free and fair. Now that's how the multi-party system is characterized within the African states. Also, such aspects like freedom of speech, association, freedom from arbitrary arrest, and the other aspects of the rule of law, transparency and accountability are still lacking in many African countries. Multi-party systems requires aspects like freedom of speech, association, freedom from arbitrary arrest, respect of rule of law, transparency, accountability to be there. But in the most of African countries, these aspects are still lacking. In short, the progress toward political liberalization, democracy, and the respect of human rights is still limited. On the other hand, there are problems within the opposition parties. There are emerging opposition parties and also their weaknesses. They lack strong leadership. They were often characterized by intra and inter-party conflicts. These aspects that we have discussed highlights how African how the multi-party systems functions or works under the current African states. Here, copious 122 students, thank you for listening. Until next time, thank you again. My name is Ahmed Musa, the course instructor from the Open University of Tanzania. Welcome indeed.